Amen. What a blessing. If you have your Bibles, you could be turning to the little book of Nahum. Nahum is after Jonah. Jonah, Micah, Nahum. We trust you've come praying for the services this morning. And the Lord's always faithful to that. Nahum chapter 1 in the very first verse. Nahum chapter 1 in the very first verse. The Bible says, "The burden of Nineveh, the book of the vision of Nahum the Eshconite." God is jealous, and the Lord revengeth. The Lord revengeth and is furious. The Lord will take vengeance on his adversaries, and he will reserve wrath for his enemies. The Lord is slow to anger and great in power, and will not acquit the wicked. The Lord hath his way in the whirlwind, and in the storm, and the clouds, and the dust of his and the clouds are the dust of his feet. He rebuketh the sea and maketh it dry, and drieth up all the rivers. Bashan languisheth, and Carmel, the flower of Lebanon, languisheth. The mountains quake at him, the hills melt, and the earth is burned at his presence, yea, the world and all that dwell therein. Who can stand before his indignation? Who can abide in the fierceness of his anger? His fury is poured out like fire. The rocks are thrown down by him. The Lord is good, a stronghold in the day of trouble, and he knoweth them that trust in him. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for your graciousness and goodness. We thank you for your word this morning. We praise you for what a treasure it is to our heart. And as the days and years go by, we see more and more that that's all there is. Lord, we pray this morning that you would touch your people here this morning, that you would encourage us in the day in which we live. Lord, we pray for the lost. Lord, this would be the morning, even the day, that you would speak life to them, that you'd bring them out of that pit of darkness into your wonderful light. We pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, I'm going to be preaching this morning on the dearest friend that I ever had, and how good he is to us, even in the days of trauma and in the days of difficulty. God is good to us. The Lord Jesus Christ is a wonderful, wonderful friend. We start in the little book of Nahum, and often these latter prophets, the last 12 books of the Old Testament, that it is referred to as the minor prophets. Now, you know, really they're not. They wrote short books, but they're not minor people. I think we get in the thinking of the day that more is better. That larger is what you need to go for. The only reason they're really delineated between the major and the minor prophets was the length of their books. That's really all that matters. So I want you to see, as we look at Nahum the preacher, that he was a mighty man of God and said some difficult things in a difficult day. Now also I want you to think about, this is not in chronological order. By that I don't mean that Nahum was after Jonah necessarily in the time in which they lived. That's just how the King James Bible is ordered. And so I want you to see what you can really look at is the problems that existed in Nahum's day to get a kind of an idea when he lived. That is the story of any of the minor prophets. I want you to see, first of all, like any good preacher, that Nahum had a specific burden. He had a burden for Nineveh. Nineveh, that great city. Nineveh really was the very one that Jonah was to go and preach to, and that he kind of declined it. He really didn't want to. You know what I can come to from that is that Nineveh must have been a very wicked city. I don't know. We know some of what was going on there, but to have two of God's men concerned about the very same place, to me, is quite significant. You know what? You need a burden. You know why churches are not on the move? It's because people don't have verbiage. They're satisfied with said, I'm saved, I can't do nothing about the rest, I'm going to sit here and enjoy the ride. You know what? Nowhere in the scriptures is that even hinted at. Rather, he said, go into all the world and preach. That's what we are left to do. And a lot of people get this thing, well, I'm not a preacher. Well, he was addressing his church at that time. And you know, preaching is not necessarily public oration like we're doing this morning. Preaching is just telling the wonderful, glorious story of Christ. That is preaching. So as he begins to study concerning, as he begins to present his burden for Nineveh, the burden of Nineveh, the book of the vision of Nahum, the Eshkolonite, the Elkishonite. Now, I think if you'll follow this, he wasn't a natural born Jew. He probably was Jewish, but that was a wicked people. It did not say of the tribe of Judah. It did not say of the tribe of Levi. So he was a different kind of person. He loved the God of the Bible, so I believe that he was Jewish in a sense. He probably went through the Jewish rites and was circumcised. And that's the thing we need to remember. You did not have to be born in the line of Jews to become a Jew. You can accept the Jewish law, and you can embrace the Jewish traditions, and the men could be circumcised, and you could become a Jew. And so I'm not real sure his origin, but I do want you to know it does not assign him to a tribe. He's just a preacher. He has a burden, and he begins to preach. Now, I want you to see in verse 2, God is jealous. Now, I want you to see that he begins his book off by describing who God is. God is jealous. Now, this is the thing about jealousy. Jealousy grows. If I had somebody that was hitting on my wife, I would be jealous. It would make me mad. And this is funny now. And when Donna and Junior sang and go about. I'm not going to say names on the internet, but their piano player rubbed me kind of in the region. I liked the kid, but I thought he was sweet on Donna. I'm like, you know what? She's mine. Lay off. Don't be near her. That's how God is to you. He has a hands-off relationship. Don't you be too involved in your work. Don't you be too involved in what this world has to offer. He is a jealous God, and when you begin courting the world and taking into the world, he's going to be upset with both of you. Whoever your person is, or your thing is, or your career, or whatever you have, he's going to be upset with that, and he's also going to be upset with you. He's a jealous God. And so when we began to thinking about jealousy, sometimes we assign that as to sin, but it is not, because our God is incapable of sin. I think sometimes how we do jealousy is sinful, but God does it in the right way. God is jealous, and the result is an action, and the Lord revengeth. Now, we understand that the Bible says God is slow to anger. But I do want you to see, he does get revenge. And that's not a very popular part of the character of God. But don't think he's forgotten. Don't think that he's put that on the back burner. You know what? These nations that blaspheme God, he will have revenge. The nation of Egypt, he will have revenge. The nation of Japan, and I'll say particularly China, where Christianity is illegal, he will have revenge. He does not forget. He will get his way. And so we see then, as we begin to look at these things, God is going to be honored and He's going to be worshipped. God is jealous and the Lord revengeth. The Lord revengeth and is furious. You know what? I fully believe we live in a time today, at least nationally speaking, that God is furious at the United States. I believe at times He's furious with Israel. And I'll give you a good example. Everybody says, well, it's the apple of His eye. Well, it is. But they ain't always served Him.
That's right.
You know what? You think about the miraculous events of 1968 when they began to claim their land back with nothing. They claimed it back with cars that they'd cut the catalytic converter off and they'd be real loud and rush into the city, and those people preceded it as artillery. And they ran. You know what? God's done that for Israel before. He blesses whatever they do. But when they attack the city, they would not go to the mount. That's why it's still in possession of the other people. And so I want you to see that no doubt God was like, go to the top. Take it. Get it while you get it. While you're there, you go the full distance. And it made Him furious when He did. Now I want you to see that God is always furious at sin. The Lord will take vengeance on His adversary. He receiveth wrath. He reserveth wrath for His enemies. Now I want you to notice something where we can get a great deal of comfort. I want you to see that He says He takes vengeance on His adversaries. Now, the redeemed, as much mistakes as we make, as much as we let the Lord down, we are not His adversary. In no way are we truly against God. That's what an adversary is. Is they're against you, they drive against you, they push against you. We don't do that. The redeemed is not that way. We let Him down, but we're not His adversity. We're not against Him. And so as He begins to say this, I want you to see that fiery indignation is reserved for people that absolutely hate God in every way. There's a wrath for the enemy. There is an anger that they'll receive. You know what? In the flesh, we can't rejoice in some sinners being destroyed. But one day, when this flesh is set aside, we'll be glory to God. I'm so glad. What a purifying thing that was. When people are cast alive into hell, you know what? We'll have the ability in that day to rejoice with God. And there's a few you can rejoice. You know what? What a wonderful, blessed thing. If you can say in a spirit that we should, the day that Madeline Marilyn O'Hare is cast into the lake of fire. That sounds kind of rough, doesn't it? The judges that said killing the unborn is cool. You're okay for it. I believe all nine of them will be cast into the lake of fire. See, we will rejoice in that day. Don't be, you know what? If you're redeemed, there's no reason for you to be upset at the judgment of God. It's just, it's right.
Right.
And praise be to God, we're not under it. So why would we be upset as an attribute of His righteous character to judge sin? The Lord is slow to anger and great in power and will not acquit or forgive or square the deal with the wicked. Now, I want you to see there's two blessed things in there. One, number one, He's slow to anger, meaning His patience. But then I want you to see He's great in power. And we'll be looking a little closer at the power and the ability of God this morning, because we want to drive home He is great in power. So you want to be on the blessings end and not on the judgment end. You want to be receiving the goodness of God and not His wrath and fury, because He's a very all-powerful being. He can make something out of nothing. That's how powerful He is. And so we see, don't get bowled up on this verse. The Lord is slow to anger, great in power, and will not at all acquit or balance the with the who? wicked. Now, I'm a sinner saved by grace, but my account has been acquitted. If you're not saved this morning, yours has not. You still owe it all. You're still in debt. You still need that account to be zeroed out. So don't think in any ways without the blood of Jesus that you're going to get out of this. Verse 4. He rebuketh the sea and maketh it dry. You know what? I fully believe this morning, if it was in the mind of God, He could dry up the Pacific Ocean. That's the biggest ocean on the planet of this earth. And He can dry it up like that. You know what? Parting the Red Sea wasn't nothing. That wasn't nothing what our God can do. It's under His will. Now, what I never have understood is this, how we can believe and say, glory to God, on the parting of the Red Sea, and we don't think He can get the light bill paid. You know what? He is in all wonderful and marvelous control. He does all things well. We don't need to stress. We don't need to be upset because this is the God we serve. He rebuketh the sea and maketh it dry and dries up all the rivers. Bashan languisheth and Carmel, the flower of Lebanon languisheth. Now that word languishes means to be dried up. It means it's on its way out. It means it's dying. You know why? Well, you know why nations come up and go away? It's because that's the way God wants it. My dad was from a little mining town in West Virginia called Milburn, West Virginia. You know what's there today? Woods and a little sign that says former town of Milburn, West Virginia. There is not even one mining shack left. Nothing. That's what my God can do. You know why Milburn don't exist anymore? Because God didn't sustain it. And you know why? One day the United States will be gone, and it is this because He doesn't sustain it. You know why there's a Tennessee this morning? It's because God sustains it, and when He removes that, it languisheth. It goes away. It doesn't exist anymore. And that is the God that we serve, and it should humble us that it seems good to Him to speak to us. The mountains quake at Him, and the hills melt, and the earth is burned in His presence, yea, the world and all that dwell therein. You know what? I fully believe this is a prediction of a time when the earth will be just as smooth. These old hills of Tennessee will be just as flat as a pancake. Because He's going to take care of the problem. See, all this is under His control and under His dominion. So why do we get upset? Wonderful question in verse 6. Who can stand before His indignation? And the answer is no one. No one. And you know what? He gets indignant, gets bothered. You know, indignation is like, why did you say that? Who do you think you are? Nobody can stand against that. And we are so wicked. He has indignation. Think about all the people that you know. You know what? Probably this is the lowest time in history where people regularly attend church, and I use that word loosely. God has indignation at that. But what are you doing? Standing home and watching the foolish TV. What are you doing? I said, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. You're to be in somewhere speaking of the things of God. Yeah. That is what you're supposed to do. You know what? He has great... That is much as going up and slapping God in the face. Saying, what you said ain't worth nothing. He's indignant at that. He's upset. He don't do jumping jacks and cartwheels because you show up to church. He's demanded you be here, and that's a minimal service. He's not proud of His soul simply because you show up. It's expected of you. Who can stand before his indignation? And who can abide in the fierceness of his anger? No one, no one, no one. And who, and of his anger, his fury is poured out like fire, and the rocks are thrown down by him. Now that's pretty grave, isn't it? That's pretty severe character of our Lord. You know what? It says there that he can throw the rocks down on us. You remember in the last days what it says in the book of Revelation? And they shall cry for the rocks to fall upon them. And you know what? They won't. But he holds them up. Like, no, no, you're not going to hide from me. You're gonna endure the punishment that I've set against you. You're not getting a rock to fall upon. And so all of that is under his hand. He's sovereign, he's holy, he's magnificent. And I love verse 7. This is the one that thrills my heart. The Lord is good. Every situation, every time, every circumstance, the Lord is good. He is a good, wonderful, marvelous, glorious God, always and forever. The Lord is good. Oh, that should thrill our hearts. One amen out of the whole congregation. The Lord is good. He is wonderful. He's marvelous and he's holy. The Lord is good. Look out this morning. You know what? You may get the boo-hoos. Our yard looks like a hayfield. It's graying up and it's fixing to rain again. You know what I say to that? The Lord is good. And when it starts raining and my yard gets a little bit higher, you know what? The Lord is good. Always and forever, the Lord is good. Everything that he does is marvelous and great and wonderful. The Lord is good. Oh, if we could get a hold of that, you know what? There wouldn't be no sleepless nights. There wouldn't be no upset. There wouldn't be no wringing of the hands because the Lord is good. What a wonderful thing. The Lord is good. A stronghold in the day of trouble. Now listen, that ain't a stronghold like you're going to hold on. You know what a stronghold is? It's a battle term. A stronghold is getting that little piece of land in a battle and staying with it. He is our stronghold. As we began to bomb the beaches of Normandy in May of 1944, we got a little bit of area against the German Empire. And we fought with it with everything that we had. It was our stronghold. And you know what? They didn't give it up. Now, we can't do it on our own. Don't think I'm saying, oh, you hold out and you stick to the stuff. No, he's our stronghold. And if he's our stronghold, and blessed be God, he is, when the attack comes your way, depend on him. When hell is furious at you and the devil throws everything he's got at you, you have a stronghold. You have something that you can depend on. You know what? You'll waver, you'll fall, but God won't. He is our stronghold. Listen, our God don't get pushed around. Our God doesn't retreat, but we do. The Lord is good, a stronghold in the day of trouble, and he knoweth them that trust in him. What a wonderful truth. You know, I told you that judgment's not for us if you trust him. He knoweth those that trust him. And you know what? The flip side is this. He knoweth those that don't. Yeah. A lot of fakes out there. Did you know that? Because the Bible says, straight is the gate, and narrow is the way, and few be there that find it. You remember back in the late 60s and early 70s, the Billy Graham Crusades, where literally tens of thousands would come. You know what they did? And I've seen people that worked them tell me, come in and say, ma'am, what denomination are you? I said, well, I'm a Baptist. Well, you need to go down to aisle 4. What kind of you? Well, I'm Presbyterian. You need to go over here to aisle 7.
And he chopped them out just like that. You know what they needed? They needed the gospel. Right. They didn't need to go talk to somebody to validate whatever religion they're part of. They simply needed to know that Jesus died. And there's salvation in Him and Him alone. And you can't say a magical prayer. My Lord speaks life to those that are His. That's what they needed to hear. So you know what? All those hundreds of thousands in the late 60s and the early 70s, only thing I do is pray for them. I think there was one in California where supposedly there was 35,000 decisions for Christ. God help us. I wonder about the 35,000 today. You know why they have to fully believe if he said, what denomination are you? You say, I'm a Catholic. You know what? If he pointed them over to the priest, they're in deep trouble. I don't believe they were saved because that priest did not tell them the way of Christ. And so we see then, when we think about the goodness of our Savior and how He sustains us and how good He completely is, why should we be upset? Man, He'll stick with you when nobody else will. When everything seems down, everything seems, the whole world's against you, you know what? He's still the dearest friend I ever had. When He rebukes me and says, Larry, what are you thinking? He's still the dearest friend I ever had. Whenever He rebukes me, even through my children or my grandchildren, He's still the very dearest friend I've ever had. We need to understand that. The Lord's good. So in the days of Nahum, when there was wickedness all about, he came to rest on this fact that God is good. And He always is. Gospel of Matthew, chapter 14. Fairly familiar verses of Scripture. Matthew 14 and verse 22. Matthew 14 and verse 22. And straightway, now there was that great wonderful meeting and the feeding of the 5,000 plus women and children. This was the conclusion of that service. It was at the end. And straightway, or immediately after, Jesus constrained or required and said, I mean for you to go get in that ship and don't give me no beef about it. He constrained them. You know what? Sometimes you're going to be required. You're going to be restrained. You're going to be put in situations, and God does it purposefully. Now, if we believe in God's sovereignty, we have to believe every situation belongs to God.
Amen.
The good, the bad, and the ugly. And let me say this. We're the ones that makes those determinations, not God. And by that, I mean whenever He says, yes, it's cancer. We're the one that says it's good or bad, not God. If God is good, it has to be good, right? Mm-hmm. Has to be good. And so when we're constrained to do something, don't fight against it. Don't give it a hard time. All you're doing is being like Jonah and causing trouble for yourself. Because He constrained them. And straightway, Jesus constrained His disciples to get into a ship and to go before Him unto the other side while He sent the multitudes away. And when He had sent the multitudes away, He went up a mountain apart to pray. Now, we have no way of knowing exactly what was said. But I bet He was praying for them people. You know what? He's probably praying up a storm. God the Father, you send a wind and you send a rain and you come down on that bunch of 12 just with full. Now He didn't go full for your ear, they'd been dead. But He says, I want you to do this. You know what? He may have been praying because we're fixing to see Him rebuke the wind and the rain. So that's under. You know what? He may have been the one to say, storm, start up. And then He prayed for their faith, and it may not wait. Remember what He said concerning, He looked at Peter and said, I have prayed for thee that thy faith fail not. You know what? We need that prayer.
You know what an illustration of us believing of God's goodness and ability? It's our faith. Do you trust Him or do you not? In every situation, in every circumstance, do you believe that He is able? That is trust. And so He prays for them, either for the storm or He prays for them, but we see that He was sovereignly, fully in control of this whole situation. He didn't need no help. And when the evening was come, He was there alone. The fish were gone and He was alone. That'd be a good sermon title. But the ship was now in the midst or the middle of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them, walking on the sea. Now, I kind of have mixed feelings about this, because if you'll find in the Gospel of Luke's account of the same things, said that they were rowing because the winds were contrary. It says they were fighting. You know what? You don't need to fight against the storm. But we do, don't we? And you know why that? It's because we think we can do something about it. Is our God sovereign or is He not?
Yeah.
You know what? Have you ever wondered about it if they just let it go? That's what Paul did, didn't he?
Yeah.
He says, you take the shipping and you get rid of it. And I think it says, let it go. And the ship went where God wanted it to go. You know what? Sometimes we just need to quit fighting against situations. Just let God be God. He's going to take you where He wants you anyway. So they's out there in the middle of the sea, and they was rowing, and fighting the storm, and being fearful, and being upset. Verse 25, and in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus came unto them walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw Him walking on the sea, they were troubled and said, it is a spirit! And they cried out for fear. Now you get the full situation here, and they're rowing and fighting the storm, and instead of just letting God, then on top of all that, here's what they see is a Hank coming walking down through there, and they said, oh no! You know what? I don't really believe in ghosts, but I believe there are demons that present themselves as others. Listen, Satan's smart. And if he wanted to present someone that, a demon that looked like my grandmother, do you think he can't do it? The Bible says even the devils can transform himself into angels of light. And so they pretty much can do what they want to. But you know what? Maybe it was a fair thing. But you know what? If you wake up and the devil's looking at you, is God still God? Sure He is. Does God have dominion over the devil, even over Satan himself? Sure He does. So why don't we trust Him? So they're up there rowing and the winds were blowing and they think it's the Lord Jesus Christ. And many times you talk about an eye of the storm. There was Jesus in the middle of the storm and they still didn't recognize Him. You know what? This morning, Jesus is in the middle of the storm. He knows exactly what's going on. And the problem is, just like the apostles, when we see when Jesus shows up in the storm, we don't even recognize Him. That's who He is. And so we find the Lord Jesus walking on the sea. And you know, I think it's another gospel. He's going to walk right on past Him. And they called Him over. You know what? Sometimes I believe we have that storm coming. And the problem is we don't call Him Jesus. We don't say, come here, help me. And He just walked right on by us. And many times we deserve that. Fully. And when the disciples saw Him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, it is a spirit. And they cried out with fear. But straightway, or a little while, or immediately, Jesus said unto them, be of good cheer, it is I. Be not afraid. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be Thou, bid me to come unto Thee on the water. And He said, come. And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. And when he saw the winds boisterous, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried, saying, "Lord, save me!" Now, I want you to see that Peter, there's two things that happened. He doubted. "Jesus, if it is you, bid me to come into you." And he said, "Peter, come." He came down out of the ship. And you know what? Peter was walking on water, just like the Lord Jesus Christ. And he got to looking around. And you know what? It broke his faith when he saw the storm. And many times it breaks our faith when we see the storm. You know what? All I can say is keep your eyes on Jesus. Eyes on Jesus. Eyes on Jesus. It may be all hell breaking loose around you, but eyes on Jesus. Be close to him. Be near him. And listen, what? That's where we shouldn't be. Now, I want you to see another thing. The storm did not sink Peter. Peter's doubt sank Peter. It wasn't the wind, and it wasn't the waves, and it wasn't the water. It was the very doubt that he had within him. And when the doubt began, he began to sink. And you know what? Every time in your own life, when you doubt, you know what? Doubting the dearest friend you ever had. That's what Peter did. He doubted the ability of Christ. And because of that, he began to sink. And when he's, verse 31, "And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him and said, O thou of little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt? And when they were come into the ship, the wind ceased." Now I want you to see that he rebukes Peter. What measure of faith are we to have? As a grain of mustard seed, right? You know what? Apparently Peter didn't have it. Or maybe he had it for a minute, and then he lost it. Now, I'm not saying he lost his salvation, don't get me wrong. But there's times in my life, and there's time in your life, if you'll be honest, that you lost your faith. Or it got pretty, pretty slim. You know what? When there's no food in the cupboard, it's tough stuff. When the house payment's due and you don't have no money, it's tough stuff. But you know what? I fully believe that you're not put in a situation by happenstance. I believe you're put there for the glory of Almighty God. So you'll know what you're made of. So hopefully it will build your faith. It will cause you to desire to continue. And so we see that this was his situation. Now go with me to the Gospel of Luke. Luke chapter 8. Luke chapter 8. Luke chapter 8. Verse 41. Luke 8 and verse 41. The Bible says, "And behold, there came a man named Jairus, and he was a ruler of the synagogue, and he fell down at Jesus' feet and besought him that he would come to his house. And he had only one daughter, about 12 years of age, and she lay a dying. But as he went, the people thronged him." Now, I want you to get two things, really. Number one, that this man had enough faith to call for Jesus. To say, you know, trouble's here. My daughter's over here dying. And I need some help. Her name is Talitha. And Talitha's dying. And I need some help. And he started coming. But now remember, at that point, the Lord Jesus was entrapped by the flesh. And people began to say, "Jesus, I want you." And remember that little woman that just touched the hem of his garment? And she got healed. And then he took time and said, "Listen, woman, you give me the glory. I healed you, and now I want all these
to hear about it. Now, can you imagine the situation with Jairus and the girl's dying, and he takes time to receive a little glory and a little honor? Now, really, Jairus had two choices. He could see the healing of that woman that had an issue of blood for 12 years and say, "Oh, man, God's able. This is good." It could have been an encouragement to him, or it could have said, "Listen, Jesus, hurry up. My daughter's dying. Till life is in bad shape. Come on." He had a choice to say that that was good. Because remember I said, God's always good. Or he could see it as a hindrance. What would you have seen it as? My two daughters lay there dying. I have to be honest. I'd have seen it as a hindrance. What about you? Listen, God don't have to jump just because you say fraud. And he does everything in the right way, and he does it always right on time. Drop down to verse 49. In the interim, you've seen the woman healed, her give great glory to God. And we pick up with Jairus again in verse 49. And while he yet spake, there cometh one from the ruler of the synagogue's house, saying to him, "Thy daughter is dead. Trouble not the master." Now, I want you to see, listen, you're going to get some bad news. You're going to have trouble along the way. And here comes his second in command and say, "Look, to life is dead. He don't have to come no more. It's too late. There's no need to bother the master. She's gone. She's out of eternity. She's not going to be back." You know what that looked like? Total defeat. And I look across the Lord's people today, and you know what I see in their eyes? I see total defeat. You don't go nowhere and see people going, "Woo! Thank you, Jesus. What a mighty sovereign God you are. Thank you for just being God. Blessed be the name of the Most High." You don't see that. You see people coming in and all down and out, and you know, clinging to their Bible and, you know, wanting to say howdy to the pastor. You know why? Because they're defeated. They got some things in their life. They're believing Jairus' daughter's dead and God can't do nothing about it. And a lot of us believe we've been defeated and God can't do nothing about it. You know what I'm here to tell you this morning? He can do something about it. He can make you victorious again. He can give you wonderful things. The only problem is we don't believe it. Now notice the Lord Jesus' advice to this young man in verse 50. "But when Jesus heard it, he answered and saying, 'Fear not, believe only, and she shall be made whole.' It was a measure of the man's faith. And when he came into the house, he suffered no man to go in save Peter, James, and John, and the father and the mother of the maiden." Now, I want you to see when he says, "Listen, don't be fearful, have faith only." A lot of people will teach that in that faith, the Jairus did the healing. No, no. What would have happened if Jairus didn't believe? Jesus wouldn't have done it. And you know what? Sometimes with the situations we find ourselves in, the problem is this. If we don't believe, so Jesus don't do it. We don't have the confidence. We don't put the faith in it. And so Jesus simply don't do it. You know what? It's a waste of time for you to pray if you don't believe God can do it. It's a waste of time. And so we see then that Jairus gets this difficult instruction, but Jairus did it. He believed Jesus was able. He believed that the Lord could do it. Verse 51, "And they came into the house, and he suffered no man to go in, save Peter and James and John, and the father and the mother of the maiden. And all wept and bewailed her, but he said, 'Weep not, she's not dead, but sleepeth.' And they laughed him to scorn, knowing that she was dead." How many times do you laugh Jesus to scorn? You say, "Well, Lord, I've never done that." If your faith is wavered, yes, you have. You know what? If Jesus says, "I can do this," he can do it. If he can make something out of nothing, believe him. If he says, I'm going to do this, believe him. Have favor. Say, well, Lord, if you're going to do it, I believe you. If you stated it, it's going to happen, then in my perception, in my understanding, it's going to happen, and I ought to give you praise for it. And he put them all out and took her by the hand and called, saying, made her rise. And her spirit came again, and she arose straightway, and he commanded to give her meat. Now, I want you to see, you remember when Elijah raised that little boy up? I think I preached on that a couple weeks ago. And how Elijah prayed and then laid down on top of him and went eye to eye with him, all that. Isn't it wonderful? He just said, may it arise. And immediately he done it. Can you? You know what? The power of Almighty God was embodied in Jesus as well. And the Bible says he's our brother. Why do we doubt him? He's the dearest friend I ever had. Me and Donna have been married, it's going to be 29 years. You know what? We never had a day when we didn't have something to eat. He's the dearest friend I ever had. We never had one day where we didn't have a place to lie down. He's the dearest friend I ever had. And Donna can be fussy about her bed. We've been working on this for 30 years and I still haven't had one suit. But you know, we've had something. You ever slept without a bed? I guess I told you a story, but didn't mean to. There was one night that Don and I didn't have a bed. We were in the mountains of Oaxaca, Mexico. And Brother Bert, he thought we desired privacy more than comfort, but he was wrong. And he put us in this little room. It was out in the mountains, maybe big as that room back there. And we laid on the floor. And I heard, and Donna heard, and Donna fussed because she's hurting. And it was cold. Before we left, I was talking to Joanna. I said, Joanna, is it cold up there? No, brother, you'll be fine. Just take what you got on. I nearly froze to death. But you know what? We did have a place to lie down, didn't we? And you know what was up above us? A roof. He's the dearest friend I ever had. Why would I possibly begin to doubt him now? Why do we doubt him? You know what? We simply need to trust Jesus. If you're lost, my best advice to you is to trust Jesus. If you have an issue in your life, just trust Jesus. If it's financial, if it's health, or you know what, you don't have to be broken down to have problems. We can be like old Peter and doubt. Has it ever crept in your mind, why am I doing this? Devil ever try to slip you a little something? You know what? Just hold fast. Cling to him. Our God is able. We need to give him glory. We need to give him honor. We need to give him praise. And we just need to trust him. Brother Jim, you come and Donald will have a verse of soul.